This brings me to the third panelist, because this is exactly what Marian and his team have been doing, which is how to bring innovation and support innovative industries in Central Eastern Europe. So, Marian, maybe also from your perspective, maybe less about the past, but more about now and future.
Thank you, Vasil. Actually, I would like to talk about the past a bit, if I may. It's a great honor to be in the company of you, Vasil, Jeffrey, and Sally. Actually, the fact that I get to sit here confirms that the shock therapy and the clinical economics theory has really worked in Eastern Europe. Because in 89, I was a seven-year-old boy living in a village close to Polish borders. There were more cows than people, and my dad wanted me to become a doctor, you know, in a state hospital, because that was the greatest thing to do at the time. And I was very lucky that I was part of the cohort of millennials, the lucky generation that I was able to travel. In 99, I got to the US on a tennis scholarship. Did my high school in Ohio, went to college, where I studied econ. You know, I had the opportunity to study on Wall Street, the Lehman Brothers. So saw the heyday of Wall Street, also the doomsday. Then I got to do good things at the World Bank for Central and Eastern Europe, but also African, Latin American countries on the infrastructure side. And then, you know, I realized, actually, I remember I had this kind of an epiphany moment in 2002 when Slovakia won the World Cup in hockey in Gothenburg, you know, and this was the greatest accomplishment of our young nation. You know, we beat Russians in the final 4-3. In the semis, we beat Canadians, and at the time I was a college sophomore at Oberlin, and I was screaming to everyone, "So maestri sveta!" None of the Americans could understand what was going on, but at the time I was thinking, you know, I really would like to do this one day, you know, to go home and set up a company in Bratislava that could put together a World Cup winning team, an investment company called IPM. And started just recruiting a lot of the smart Slovaks who were frustrated sitting in London or New York or in Asia, reading the local newspapers online about what's happening in Slovakia, and kind of dreaming to come back, but didn't know, you know, how to return. They were looking for that gateway to go back. You know, Bratislava became the nucleus. It became kind of our, you know, I call it, it's an Omaha, Nebraska of Europe, because by being in Bratislava, we were able to escape the cognitive prison of the big financial centers, you know, New York, London. We were truly independent in our thinking, in the way we're looking at things. And I was very lucky that, you know, the team has grown from Bratislava. We opened San Francisco office. We opened London office, Seoul, Korea, Hong Kong. We have invented that we call InfraTech, which is an idea where you make a venture investment in a Silicon Valley company, and then you turn it into an infrastructure project by bringing the technology to Slovakia. And we became the fastest growing asset manager in Europe, not despite being in Slovakia, but thanks to being in Slovakia. And it's the fact that, you know, the region has gone through so much hardship. You know, I mean, we've got Nazis at our, you know, back door, communists, you know, which really impose such destruction of social values. But innovation throughout this time was kind of a way how to get out of this hardship. The flying car technology coming out of Slovakia, the reason why it was actually created was because people were standing at the Danube, and in 89 they were thinking, like, how do we get, or 88, how do we get to the, you know, other side of Danube, you know, to the other side of the Iron Curtain? And they thought of flying car would be fantastic. We could fly over the river and we can be on the right side of history, you know. And the first parachute was invented by a Slovakian guy. The father of thermodynamics comes from Liptovský Mikuláš. And on top of it, you have an incredible, I call it hockey team mentality. You know, Slovaks, and I think all Eastern Europeans, you know, at least in kind of the Danube Valley region where we operate, you know, they're amazing when they get excited about something. You know, they create this force of nature. They get together, and this is why, you know, Slovakia, when you look at it historically, always beats the US at the World Cup in hockey. You know, it's amazing. We lose to all the small nations, but we get to get together and really, you know, as a David take on the Goliath. You know, the David and Goliath story has been really powerful in our modern history. And for the first time, we're seeing that actually Eastern Europe is not justifying its existence. You know, we're actually making an impact in Europe. And, you know, we went from the region that has been called the black hole of Europe by Madeleine Albright. And, you know, we honor her, obviously, and she's entitled to her opinion. But the region now moved into such a big innovation hub where, you know, we are the biggest car manufacturer per capita in the world. And, you know, we're building projects like InnoBad, which is one of our portfolio companies that has invested in R&D companies in San Diego, which have the most advanced high-throughput technology in battery materials. And we're bringing this sophisticated technology into Slovakia, and we're converting it into a production plant that will actually develop customized batteries for OEMs. And Slovakia happens to have 9 out of 18 OEMs in the region there. So it's an incredible manufacturing base, Europe's existential problem. And I would like to pick up on what Jeffrey said. Europe is really, European civilization is at a crossroads. We have fallen behind 10, 20 years behind the Chinese. There's no alternative to it, we know it. But actually Europe doesn't have a single battery producer with a European IP that is actually producing batteries for EVs. It's all you know, coming from China. The Chinese battery production is 3 times the size of the production of the US and Europe combined. You know, it's a technological sovereignty crisis that Europe is facing right now. And it's incredible that we're seeing this paradigm shift where, you know, we went from the days where the European IP was being converted into production in China. Now actually the Chinese technology is being assembled and manufactured in Europe. Glad to say that actually the two biggest areas that have been identified by Brussels as the core areas of focus are the battery project and human brain project, basically boosting Europe's capability to be able to actually compete with the Chinese when it comes to quantum computing, you know, to actually have their own European semiconductor chip base. And I'm glad that IPM is now founding two companies that are really solving the problem and with the underlying knowledge and the founders coming from Silicon Valley. One is InnoBad for batteries, I mentioned, and the other one is Techium, where the founder sits in California and he happens to be Slovak American, and you know, this is a guy that people don't know about, but this is a man who built the GPU chip for PlayStation 2. He built a chip for Tianhe, the world's super fastest computer in the world, which happens to be Chinese. And now he's building the chip that will be able to address the biggest problem we have right now, is the energy consumption of data centers, you know, which if you combine the data centers of Google, LinkedIn, Facebook combined, they actually burn more electricity than is the UK consumption per year. So, you know, we have Central Eastern European projects and founders that are actually solving Europe's biggest existential problems. And I'm very proud of that, that, you know, we're finally putting the region on the map and becoming relevant. Well, corruption is the sad stigma for the region of the past. You know, it's important not to look at the region as a basket because, you know, each of the countries have made, I think, incredible headways in improving, you know, on this topic. When it comes to projects and investments in startups and venture investments, especially the ones investing in deep tech hardware companies that are capital intensive, you know, you get into this Darwinian world, you know, where really it's about survival of the fittest, and there's no room for corruption, because if you really want to build a battery production company or a chip manufacturing company, you clearly need to go for sources of capital that, you know, come from Brussels, from the likes of SoftBank, you know, the investors that have very rigorous KYC requirements, and there, you know, any signs of corruption, any signs of weakness in corporate governance structure are heavily penalized, and the projects are not getting funded. You know, so thanks to the Czech therapy, I'm gonna go back to it, and the integration that the region has reached and being now truly part of the Euro-Transatlantic and the European Union structures, the venture investments coming from the region are now, you know, getting funding from the likes of the European Investment Bank, from the Brussels, are successful candidates, you know, in the Horizons grant schemes, and I think, you know, the bigger problem when it comes to startups in the region is still this heavy bias, you know, the preference for Western as opposed to Eastern projects, the East and West divide, which is still very prevalent, and I think this is a much bigger challenge, you know, in the quest of Europe to really unify its efforts and rally behind the biggest projects, including the ones in our part of the world. Thank you.